come over here. So I'll be talking about building buzz with creative content. It's kind of an interesting topic. The reason I put those numbers over there on the right is because that is the results of one of the very, very first campaigns that we did for Attentive. Nobody had heard of Attentive yet. We were a brand new startup. We had no marketing budget. And for one of the very, very first content marketing campaigns we did, we had about 280,000 visitors in one day. We got 644 backlinks to our website, and I was actually interviewed on LA Drive Time Radio. It's kind of a weird coincidence that that all came together. But I'll be talking about how we can use creative content, because that's something that's thrown around so frequently, content marketing, but how we can really use it to tap into that buzzy atmosphere that's on the internet. It works now. All right. So there's a really big opportunity with content marketing. 67% of marketers say that blogs, specifically, are the most effective method. And I would have to agree with that. The internet has changed a lot of things, and blogs can now be your personal content marketing publishing platform. It used to be that if you wanted to get something out there, you had to hire a publisher, or you had to print something, or you know, you had to pay somebody to stick it in a magazine. Now, anybody can say just about whatever they want at any given point in time, and it's a blessing and a curse. But marketers, most marketers, think that it is the most effective way to get your content out there. And here's some evidence of that. So here are the percentages of social shares from these two major news organizations that was sponsored content specifically. So 35% of the New York Times social shares last year was sponsored content. This is not content that a reporter went out and dug up a story. This was content that a company came and said, I want to be mentioned in a story, I want a story written about this particular subject. And then they wrote it. And 35% of their shares came from that sponsored content. It's a powerful thing. NPR is even bigger. Over half of their social shares last year were sponsored content. So content marketing is a really big opportunity. Lots of marketers think it is, and everybody can tap into it through the internet.
Can you clarify what sponsored content? Do you mean like Facebook's, like when people sponsor things on Facebook? Or people are paying NPR to get in their stories?
Yeah, yeah. In fact, this is a trend that's going across all news outlets just about, because people are starting to ignore ads on the side. Like it's one of those kind of things that we've become accustomed to over time. And because people have started to ignore ads so much and click rates are dropping, they're turning to new ways of advertising. And so if you read a Mashable article, for example, at the top, it will say sponsored at the top when you start reading it. But that will still be an article that was sponsored by a particular company, right? And there's a really thin line there between
journalism
and advertising. And they try to self-police, you know, and make sure that nobody's crossing that line. But still, the fact that content is so shareable and so valuable, and that it's something that's becoming a major part of their businesses and what people read is an important thing.
Just going to say, if you listen to podcasts, the Startup podcast goes into this in depth, because they've been struggling with how they do that at revenue generation as part of their podcast. Startups, it's a podcast about starting up a podcast. They get into this really in depth, and it's great.
Wow.
Yeah.
So I'm just trying to get clear. So 35% of content that was shared.
So say they had 100 tweets last year of their stuff. It was obviously much more than that.
Yeah.
35 of those tweets were tweeting out sponsored content.
And so we're talking about tweets that have what, at the New York Times in them, or this is what we're.
No, like a link to that specific New York Times article that was sponsored.
Okay.
Yeah. So there's definitely a big opportunity there. But what that also means is that there's a huge challenge. Everybody is doing this. Everybody has a publishing platform, so everybody is publishing. An average of 2.5 million blog posts are published daily. This is worldwide, obviously. But 2.5 million, that's crazy, crazy amounts of content. And the median lifespan of content is actually pretty short. It's only about 3.2 days. And the way they measure that is in terms of engagement and social shares. So at about the 3.2-day mark is when that arc of social shares really drops off for almost all content. There are some exceptions, but generally, the amount of time that you have to make an impact and generate that buzz is fairly short. But what I want to talk about is three different focuses that we've had and that pretty much anybody can implement to overcome those challenges and really tap into that buzz. So the first is testing channels, and obviously I'll be explaining each of these in depth. Second is high-value content, and the third is amplifying opportunities. So that first focus of testing channels, and what do I mean by testing channels? There are so many different avenues that you can pursue to get your content out there. You can go down social, you can go down print, you can go down paid advertising. If you pick social, there's Pinterest, there's Facebook, there's LinkedIn, there's Twitter, there's all of these, and there's new ones popping up every day. There's so many different avenues that you could potentially focus on, and some people get lost in that mire. And so testing your channels and figuring out what works best can really help focus your efforts, especially if you're on a shoestring budget, which as a startup we were. It's just a great way to make sure that you're getting the most bang for your buck. So three bullet points here. The first is what I was talking about, making sure that whatever it is that you're trying to accomplish, you match that and your target market with the right social channel. So Attentive, for example, Attentive is a software for communication across different companies and collaboration. And one of our kind of selling points was that we'll help get rid of wasteful meetings, right? For business people specifically. So we thought, what channels would work best for those business aspects? Pinterest was probably not one of them. There's not a lot of people curating software on Pinterest. There are a few, but not a lot. LinkedIn, however, you do see a lot of that. Twitter, you do see a lot of that. So we started to narrow down our focus. Once we had our focus narrowed, we started cultivating what I like to call a get the ball rolling base. Get the ball rolling is a metaphor I like to use with specifically a snowball, and it's very pertinent seeing how much snow we've gotten recently. But as you start rolling a snowball down the hill, there's enough snow, it starts to pick up more snow. And it's just kind of how the internet buzz theme works. As things start rolling, more and more shares start going out, and eventually it's just this behemoth snowball. But somebody has to make that snowball to get it started. Something has to happen to get that ball rolling. And so cultivating a get-the-ball-rolling base is getting people, a small group of people, that can give you that first set of tweets or that first set of shares on LinkedIn. For us, it was every employee at Attentive had social accounts at our target social platforms. All of their spouses had them. If they had old enough children, they had them. And we just got that ball rolling with this get-the-ball-rolling base, which has just been so pivotal. Finally, once you've got that base ready, you can start testing out different genres of content. So let me give you some examples of that. So we wanted to start testing out these different themes that we had for Attentive. So one of the first things we tried was posting guides about meetings and about doing business and collaboration. So we tweeted this out, 7 sins of deadly meetings. And as you can see, there's no retweets, there's no favorites, there's no replies, there's no engagement whatsoever. People didn't like that one. So we tried something else. We tried going the funny route. We posted this. It just says, we will continue having lots of meetings until we find out why no work is getting done. That got a little better response. It got 4 retweets and then 2 favorites. We continued to test these different genres out until we had a pretty good spread. And we kept track of what got the most engagement, and we eventually found that our target market were mostly responding to statistics. Statistics were the winner. Every time we tweeted out a stat, that almost always got more engagement than a guide. Anytime we tweeted out a stat about meetings, that almost always did better than some news item. And so we hunkered down and focused on that stat aspect. So now that we had our base ready, we had our challenge tested, it was time to create some high-value content. And I put high-value in there because so many people create content. 2.5 million blog posts a day of content. Are all of them high-value? Probably 10 of them. I don't know. We have a very small margin of all of those blog posts are actually valuable. So, how do you make your blog post or your content or your marketing strategy valuable? Obviously, focus on your best channel. So for us, it was statistics. Make sure your content is shareable or viral ready. I really like the viral ready kind of phrase to describe this because lots of content gets the opportunity to go viral, but it's not ready for it. Mm-hmm. It's very possible that whatever that infographic that you put together last week came across somebody's social stream and the person had 1,000 followers that they could have retweeted about to. But it wasn't viral ready, it wasn't shareable. Even if it was good content, they couldn't really share it, and so it missed that opportunity. So make sure it's viral ready, and I'll be giving examples of that. And then have your content ready to promote on non-social forums. Social media is such a focus when we start thinking, how are we going to get this out there? But be ready to promote it on other non-social forums, on discussion threads. Going and finding an article that's related to what you're talking about it with the people in the comment section. Be ready to do that. So here's an example. This is our very, very first piece of high-value content. We had finished our testing, figured out stats was our goal of mine, and we just dug into that. And we built this, it wasn't super long, but it was almost like a report that was broken up into different shareable aspects. And so this was the very top of the report. It was just this image. You can see there's some more analysis text, and there was more images below. But this is the very first image people came across, and right off the bat, there's three things that people could latch onto and share in the very limited time they were going to spend on a post. First one was $338, average salary cost of a meeting. Somebody could just only read that and decide to tweet it out. It's already shareable. If they didn't like that, they could keep moving down. And right off the bat, there are many different things that they can latch onto and start sharing. And it was successful. You can see on our social media bar here, this was without paid advertising. This was, we launched about 2 months before. We really hadn't made any kind of a name for ourselves. And we had over 500 tweets. It says 1,500 upvotes on Reddit. That eventually got to 3,000. We had 2,500 likes on Facebook, over 100 pluses on Google Plus, which is great, because Google Plus is kind of a ghost town. And then almost 1,000 LinkedIn shares, all without paying a dime. And it was because once we got it out there, it was viral ready. Once we got it out there, people were willing to upload it on Reddit because they thought it was interesting. It was something of high value. Here's some examples of what people were tweeting at. So Julia at the top there, she found a statistic that we had in there and said, on average, people think 33% of meeting time is unproductive. And that's what she decided to tweet out. David just tweeted out our title, America Meets a Lot, right? That's all he decided to tweet it out. Kyle latched on to one of these graphs that we did about most common meeting types that was further down in the article. And each of these things was broken up. Let me give you an example. With GoFish Digital, we're consulting this group right now that put tons of money into making this huge report. And it was a wonderful report. It was 100 pages, and it was full of great insight, and they were very bummed when nobody talked about it. And when I looked at it, I was like, well, if I'm going to tweet something out, it's probably not going to be a 100-page report. And so we're working with them now to break it into these shareable snippets, all of those gold, little gold nuggets in that huge report, making them shareable and viral ready. And this is what it did to our website. On an average day, we were very proud. We would have about 11 visitors on our website concurrently. Any given time during the peak hours of the day. The day we posted this, as it was going viral, we had over 3,000 visitors at one point in time. And these were people constantly churning, and it averaged, you can kind of see the bar here, it averaged right around above 3,000 throughout the day. And it was all from this one piece of content. Now, amplifying opportunities. So if you've tested your channels, you've figured your correct channel, built that high-value content that's ready to go viral, and you started promoting it and sharing it, hopefully some opportunities will come your way. And it is amazing how often after people push out their content, they just say, okay, I'm done. And they don't stick to it and see how many other things that they can, how many other snowballs they can start rolling based off of that. So a couple of things that I want to point out here is, first, assume people are bad at promoting their content. This is kind of a golden rule for me because it's so true. Even big news agencies are really bad at promoting their own content. They'll put out a cool article and then they'll just tweet on their company account, and that will be all of the promotion that they do. So assume people are very bad at it, because it's usually true. Once you see somebody else writing about your content, or once you see somebody linking to it, or an influencer tweeting about it, apply those same channel strategies that you had and that you tested to that outside content. So if somebody writes an article about you, apply those channel strategies. Figure out Twitter and statistics were our best bets. How can we take this article and make it Twitter ready? What's a snippet inside of that article that we can draw out and quote in our tweets as we start engaging people? And making their message shareable. A lot of times, the title just doesn't quite work. Somebody wrote an article about Attentive a while back that just said, new software comes out of DC. That was the title. And a lot of software just come out of DC. And it, no, I wouldn't read that if I came across it. And so we had to dig down where, down at the bottom, somebody had said, this software enables introverts in the workplace. Already, that's much more interesting than the title. And so we decided to quote that as we started putting it out. So some case studies from this. We got Attentive's launch story published by Fast Company, which was a great victory. When they published it, we assumed they were bad at promoting their own content. It's kind of hard to see up here, but you can see it says 1,300 shares. A typical Fast Company article about a new software will get maybe between 200 to 400 shares. We tripled that because we started promoting it. We took this article and we posted it on Reddit. And we took it to the forums, and we started promoting it on social. Even though we didn't produce it, it was about us, and we counted. Eventually, it was getting enough shares and enough visits that Fast Company and their algorithm that I'm sure they have decided to bump our story up to the front page of their website. So what could have been just an okay opportunity now became a huge opportunity, and we magnified it that way. Another example. Technically, DC is a local news outlet. I like them a lot. They don't have quite the reach of Fast Company. But still, when they decided to write a story about us, we did the same thing again. We pushed it out there and made sure that it got lots of hits, lots of visits, lots of tweets. And the reporter that wrote this story on us contacted me like a day or two after it went live and said, Daniel, let me know if you guys do anything else because we want to write about it. I was like, okay, then. This is great. Great to have a reporter waiting to, see my emails. Another example. We got that launch story in Fast Company. We promoted it so that it then got pushed to the front page. But we didn't stop there. We decided to make new content about how we got our launch story published in Fast Company and kept that ball rolling. This also did pretty well. The rest of the blur gets cut off, but it got 260 tweets without any promotion and without anybody really, following our Twitter account yet, because people were interested in it. So some takeaways. Testing and picking the best channels I think is so important, because otherwise you'll just spend all of your time trying to make a different image for every different social account, trying to make content for everything under the sun, and you'll never focus in on whatever it is that is your goal line. Making sure that you make high value content that people are willing to share, that's actually shareable, that's able to be broken up into snippets. People can just tweet out and get into that small character limit. And then amplify, keep that ball rolling. It's amazing the opportunities that can come when you don't stop at the initial promotion and you watch and wait and see what other opportunities come out of that. And that's all I've got. Thank you very much. I don't know if anybody has any questions or comments.